Now it's our turn to, sorry for the words, but put our balls on the table.
Remember, kids, this is not how you play hockey. It's just ugly.
I like it.
Who are you guys?
You know what? I love ice cream too.
Go back to Canada, Guy Lafleur.
Game on!
Yeah, game on!
Ah, it's so good to hear that intro again. Hello, and welcome into the hockey show right here on Mile High Sports, Colorado's biggest and best live hockey radio show. JJ Jerez here, back off, what, 6 week hiatus? 7 week? I couldn't remember.
It felt like a season.
Really? It was that bad for you? Well, shout out.
No, it was that nice.
Yeah. No, you must have hated it. It must have been stressful. Not as much joy in your life. Not as much laughter. You had to build your own shows, which I know you're terrible at.
Oh, man.
And you had to go around and beg people to come hang out with you. Shout out to Jesse Montano for filling my seat a little bit. Megan Angley did a great job as well. And you even did a show solo. So props to you. I really respect that.
I was building off of your solo intro that you did that one day, and you're like, I wanted the challenge. So I was like, let's see if I can do it. I did get to say Colorado's biggest and best live radio show right in front of Jesse, to Jesse's face.
Well, he doesn't have a radio show.
I know. He was like, wait, I mean, technically it's
yeah,
right.
Exactly. Yeah. That's why I always say it. Don't tell anybody else, though. Keep that on the low. But anyway, I'm happy to be back. Happy to talk some hockey. A lot to talk about. A lot went on this week, right? I mean, as we're approaching the final couple weeks of the regular season here and the playoffs right around the corner. But we got to start the show like we start every single show. That's Matinee Money.
Let's start the show proper, shall we?
Careful, we're going to get a cease and desist there. My pick today, of course, one game already going on. That's Tampa Bay versus the Boston Bruins. And then the other Matinee Money going on is the Detroit Red Wings taking on the Philadelphia Flyers. Both the Red Wings and the Lightning were the underdogs in this game. I think these games are too close to really pick a winner. They're good games. So for my Matinee Money picks, I took the underdogs to cover the 1.5. So they either have to lose by one or do better. So they can win or lose by one. I parlayed both of those, the Red Wings and the Lightning, plus 129. I love plus odds. Let's go with it.
I feel like I have this perception in my head that Tampa isn't doing well. And maybe it's just because I see some losses where I'm like, oh man, shouldn't have lost, or that was a bad loss. But they're third in their division in the standings right now. I just have a hard time betting against Boston, even though I know you're not really betting against Boston. So I took the opposite of you and threw in Seattle because I'm greedy. And I went with the minus 1.5 for Boston, for Philly, and like I said, threw in Seattle at a plus 2,197.
Oh, you're going for the home run.
Yeah, but only, I mean, three. It's not like a 13-game parlay. It's doable, but we'll see.
Yeah, I've been all about the two-game parlays lately. For some reason, I've been seeing some success with that, but here I am, 16 years after betting, still trying to figure out the best strategies and methods. I don't know if I'll ever get it.
I saw an Esquire article that I was pretty sure it was written by you, and it was, I lost $500,000 gambling on sports, and I'm not going to stop. And I was like, did JJ write this? I keep meaning to click and see if that's what you were doing during your time off.
Yeah, you know, so there are times I'll lay a heavy bet and it's like, it's weighing on your head. Like, man, if I lose this, this is going to stink. But I'm not going to stop betting. It's not going to stop me from betting, even if I lose a fat amount, because the only way you're not going to recoup that is by not betting, right?
Yeah, that's what an addict would say. I definitely feel a lot of shame every time I have to put money back in my account. I'm like, why am I doing this?
It's worse when, you know, you'll withdraw some and then a couple days later just deposit that exact same amount that you just withdrew.
I've never withdrawn any. That's probably the problem.
That's unfortunate.
Well, when you're betting like I am with a plus 2197.
Going for home runs.
You don't win a lot.
You don't have a big bet. Looking at that Boston-Tampa Bay game, I think the real thought from me is that Boston might have just mailed it in at this point of the season, right? I mean, a couple weeks ago, we saw them lose to the Chicago Blackhawks. We've seen some ugly losses out of Boston. They pretty much have the President's Trophy wrapped up. They're waiting for playoff time. I can see a team like Tampa Bay, you know, sneaking up on Boston. But with that being said, I wanted to get into the biggest standing stories, you know, looking at the standings, both Eastern and Western, looking at maybe playoff scenarios. What are the storylines that are standing out to you as maybe the most favorite? I'll start, maybe give you a second to think about it.
I just wanted to say first that Boston's won 6 in a row. So,
okay, so they're back. They're back on track.
Not mailing it in.
They're back on track.
Yeah.
I'm loving the race for 8th in the East Conference, and that's between the Pittsburgh Penguins, who we just saw here in Denver the other night, and the Florida Panthers. I have a little affinity in my heart for Florida, of course, so I'm really rooting for them. But it's an exciting battle. I mean, those are two good teams, two teams with a lot of talent, two teams with stars fighting for that final spot. I mean, I mean, we've all been anticipating the Eastern Conference playoffs, but I think these playoffs as a whole are just going to be some of the best we've seen in decades.
Yeah, I'm really just excited for the whole East in general. It's going to be a dogfight over there. There's a lot of teams that I think could be legit Stanley Cup contenders that won't make it out of the first round. And like you said, Pittsburgh, you know, I like to say that teams that I have a fantasy player on, I pay more attention to. I'm acutely more aware of their trials and tribulations. And Pittsburgh is one of those teams where so is Florida. But you know, I've had Tristan Jarry on my team all season, so I've been invested in how they're performing. And coming into that game against the Avalanche, it was like, this team cannot get out of their own way. They gave up like 6 goals in back-to-back games to the Rangers and lost. Jarry was pulled in 4 of 5 starts, and it was a perfect storm scenario where I was like, I bet the Penguins, they lost 2-1 to Ottawa. Coming into Colorado, I was like, this is the game where they turn it around. It just felt like that was a possibility. And you got to see, I thought, a not great game from the Avalanche, but a pretty expert game from the Penguins. And so that's something that gets me excited for that, like you said, that wild card kind of play-in situation that's unfolding. Both of these teams have their fate in their own hands, but they kind of can't get out of their own way sometimes to get the win. And I think a lot of it's going to come down to goaltending.
Well, and then, okay, so let's say they do get into the playoffs. Who do they have to face? The Boston Bruins, who are clearly the best team in the NHL. So looking at the two, Pittsburgh Penguins or the Florida Panthers, I feel like we're just going to get a better series out of a Florida Panthers versus the Boston Bruins than the Penguins versus Bruins. I feel like the Bruins are just going to truck the Penguins.
Probably. Like, you never want to count Sidney Crosby out, I think. But there are players on Florida quietly having really good seasons. Matthew Tkachuk is one of them. You know, Barkov, he's been hurt, but he's doing it. I think just the biggest question mark is always Bobrovsky in the postseason. And it's not just regular season Bobrovsky. This is a goalie who has historically struggled in high pressure situations. And you can't totally say that it's his fault, right? But I mean, we're talking playoffs in Columbus. We're talking Olympics. We're talking playoffs in Florida.
You never know which Bobrovsky you're going to get. Yes, he's a good goalie, but every once in a while he comes and lays an egg. And, you know, it's often in pivotal games. I wouldn't say it's exactly in every big game, but
yeah.
He's very inconsistent. It's almost 60-40 if you're going to get a good versus bad Bobrovsky. Yeah.
He's either on or off the case, Bobrovsky.
In or out. Let's get to maybe the Western standings. Any storylines you're looking at there? I mean, obviously we're keeping a close eye on where the Avalanche land. Do they ultimately take home ice advantage and maybe play the Minnesota Wild? Do they take over the first in the Central and maybe get a swing at somebody like the Kraken or maybe even the Oilers first round? We'll see how that ultimately lands. But is there anything that stands out to you as something you're keeping a close eye on?
Well, right now I want to see Seattle make it. And so I'm keeping an eye on that. Like, they've got a good cushion. Nashville, I mean, that was a team that started selling off, right? Now they're knocking on the door. They're 5 points behind Winnipeg. They've got 3 games in hand. Like, for a long time this season, the Avalanche had the fewest games played out of any team, and that's Nashville now. They've only played 70, so they've got 12 games left. The Avalanche are at 71, so they've got 11. Winnipeg, they got to do it. You think they're going to. They got a plus 15 goal differential. Nashville's minus 6. Things haven't been going their way, but, you know, kudos to them for hanging around there. Calgary, super disappointing. Expected more out of them. This is a team last year, I know obviously things have changed, that I thought could have given the Avalanche a real run for their money. You know, it's always exciting to see Connor McDavid in the playoffs because it hasn't happened a lot historically. When Edmonton won that game and Calgary lost and Edmonton moved on to play the Avalanche, I was like, man, I think this is going to be a quick series. you know, just goaltending, Drysdale's hurt, the defensive situation, knowing
Calgary was good.
Calgary looked really good. Mm-hmm. So it's disappointing, this kind of follow-up. We've heard some rumblings of players saying, if Daryl Sutter's back next year, I'm not.
I mean, I think that's obvious, right? I think that's the obvious X factor in whether or not they can succeed. I mean, last year, you see Johnny Gaudreau and Matt Tkachuk leave. I think that's a glaring sign of them being unhappy. Not necessarily, oh, we just want to do the best for our families, get more money. They just wanted a change of scenery because they needed out. And why did they need out? Because their coach is miserable to play under. I mean, you can tell just from listening to press conference. He's a grumpy, curmudgeon old man that you would hate to take orders from or hate to have him be the authoritarian in your life. So you see this year, Calgary came out of the gate pretty strong. That first month, Calgary looked good again. And you're like, all right, Calgary's going to do it. And then all of a sudden they fell off. Why do they fall off? Because that message gets lost from the coach. The players suddenly say, I'm not buying into this a-hole anymore.
And it's a really rigid structure, too. I think that's part of what you're saying, right? Mm-hmm. Like, you have to play in this rigid structure. There's not a lot of room to create outside of it. And that can be stifling.
And if you're not throwing your body around and maybe even putting yourself in harm's way, you're falling out of your coach's favor, which is a tough thing to deal with, too, right? You want to score goals, but he wants you to go hit people.
I know you don't watch Yellowstone, Danny. Are you a Yellowstone watcher?
Big Yellowstone fan.
We're not talking about Yogi the Bear. Hey, boo-boo, do you want a picnic basket? Daryl Sutter came out to his morning skate in Denver here in a nice Western shirt. And somebody from the Calgary media said, nice shirt. And he said, thanks, it's my Yellowstone shirt. And I guess a lot of people hadn't watched the show, so they didn't really understand where he was going, and he just paused and he goes, take him to the train station. And everybody started laughing, and the people, a lot of Calgary media, hadn't watched the show and didn't get it. And, you know, spoiler alert, the train station is where they take someone in this unpopulated county between like Wyoming and Montana, and they kill people and throw them into this ravine, and they likely won't be found. So it was a funny joke that, whew, but so he can have some humor to him, you know, but it's really dry.
Yep, indeed. Indeed. So, yeah, I guess we'll see how everything pans out. I think the Avalanche right now sitting in the third spot do have a chance at getting the second, but I think the Central might be, a long shot. They're only 1 point out of it. They have Arizona coming up, but I think these other teams are playing for something as well, and it might be a tough get for the Avalanche.
Yeah, we'll see. And I wanted to dip back just to Seattle real quick. How exciting is it going to be for that city and organization to make the playoffs? You know, obviously last year didn't go the way they wanted, but this turnaround, this about face that they've had has been outstanding. They've played some good games against the Avalanche. You know, I think Dave Hextall deserves a lot of credit. Whereas last year, I've said this before, I constantly was wondering if he was the right guy for the job. And then when you look at the Avalanche, I mean, this is a team a month ago, and I talked to Jared Bednar about this the other morning. We're not in a good playoff position. Like a month ago, we were talking, are you focused on just getting in? And he said, absolutely. And now here we are. This team is, you know, pushing for first in the division. I mean, potentially first in the West.
Yep. We'll see how it all pans out. But yeah, Seattle will be fun. You just felt so bad for that fan base last year. They were all aboard, right? And they had such good showings at their games only to fall on their face. So good for them to be rewarded with some playoff hockey, a little extra revenue for Seattle too, which is what the NHL wants, right? They want these new teams to make money, and so far they've been doing so. So, yeah, it's break time. We've got Joe Smith of The Athletic, who covers the Minnesota Wild, formerly used to cover the Tampa Bay Lightning. This will be a fun little conversation with him coming up next. We'll talk Wild, since that's really the Avs' next big game. They've got Arizona, they got Anaheim, but then they've got the Minnesota Wild, and like we said, that's a potential first-round playoff matchup. So, fun conversation. Stick around through the break right here on The Hockey Show. It's JJ Jerez, Ryan Boulding, Danny Bailey behind the glass, Mile High Sports.
Right now, it's 16 minutes past the big hour. Is that not right, Mr. Scream? Great, good stuff. I think people are getting really cranked.
Welcome back. It's The Hockey Show, Colorado's biggest and best live hockey radio show. JJ Jerez, Ryan Boulding. We are heading to the phones, out to Joe Smith, who covers the Minnesota Wild for theathletic.com, formerly used to cover the Tampa Bay Lightning. So we got to hang some have some time in his presence last summer, which was, you know, obviously an exciting time for us. But Joe, thanks for hopping on the show with us today. We know the Avs play the Wild in a big game later this week. Of course, both teams have a couple games in between, but going to be a lot on the line on Wednesday. So I guess just to start, what are the sentiments from the Minnesota Wild fans as far as playing the Colorado Avalanche in the first round of the playoffs? Because if the playoffs started tomorrow, that's exactly how it would be.
Yeah, good to join you guys. Yeah, it's an interesting situation because, you know, like they've been kind of like the sleeping giant all year, right? Like they're banged up and, you know, kind of out of a playoff spot, but now they're kind of coming on strong. So I don't know if there's really a team that wants to play them in the first round, quite frankly. They're defending champions, and you know that they're going to make a push. So I think a lot of the teams, Minnesota included, want to win the division, you know, not just to win the championship, but also to get a better, probably better matchup. But yeah, it's going to be a fun playoffs all around the West. The Eastern Conference are probably more loaded, but I think they'll still be so wide open in the West. It'll be so exciting playoff hockey. But the Wild have been on a really impressive stretch of hockey, and so that's without Kirill Kaprizov, who they plan to have back before the playoffs. So I would love to see a seven-game series between Minnesota and Denver, not just to visit Denver a couple more times.
I guess to follow up on that, you know, I feel like Minnesota even started the regular season a little slow out of the gate, and then, you know, you see the Jost waiver, and then you see the Ryan Reeves addition, and that felt like really when things started to click for Minnesota. Is that kind of how you saw it being close to the team, or was there another important happening that kind of turned this team around, turned the season around for them?
Well, like they started off 0-3. They got 20 goals in the first three games, which was kind of an anomaly. So, like, their goaltending has been terrific the rest of the year, so that's been a big part of the turnaround, as well as their play defensively. It's been really good. So I think, and then I think Ryan Reeves just added kind of an alpha personality in the room, loosened things up, and this is a really tight group, so it'll be, that was a big factor, I think, in just getting that presence there. But overall, they've been pretty much in a playoff spot, and then they kind of made a big turnaround. The biggest turning point, I thought, was like a team meeting they had right out of the All-Star break, and they lost a couple straight, lost to Vegas 5-1. They kind of had a team-wide chat, just kind of like, relax, don't be so tight, and just kind of play your game. It's going to happen, and they kind of took off from there.
And Joe, you mentioned the absence of Kirill Kaprizov, obviously a big offensive component for the team. But how important has it been to have the other guys stepping up, you know, the Matt Boldys and those guys, especially knowing that Kevin Fiala left the team in the offseason and is having, you know, a very good year for the Kings? Like, how important has this secondary, tertiary scoring been for this Minnesota team?
It was kind of funny because, like, they scored, like, 18 goals in the first three games, so like a freeze-off. I think Dean Evason called them dead weight, just joking around. Like, who needs Kirill? But I think it really let the guys kind of come out of their shell a bit and know that they couldn't just rely on this MVP candidate to give them scoring. And so Ryan Reeves scored 3 goals in 4 games. Mason Shaw was scoring goals. But Matt Boldy has been the most impressive or most important, I think, development here. Their second best, you know, offensive player behind Kaprizov went on to scoring 7 goals, I think, in his last 5 games and had a hat trick. Because if they want to go anywhere, they need a guy like him to really be really pivotal in their offense. So his emergence and then Marcus Johansson they got from the Caps at the deadline really has kind of, you know, helped him on his line. So overall, I think it, you know, when Kirill comes back, he'll come back to a more well-rounded offensive team.
I think that makes them extra lethal. And you mentioned goaltending. Obviously, there's a big game on Wednesday between the Avalanche and the Wild. Both of these teams kind of have their own fate in their own hands and can kind of make what they will out of it. I'm a Marc-Andre Fleury fan, so this isn't a dig at him, but he didn't have a very good showing the last game. You know, is there a way for this team to kind of throw that one out and reset, you know, on the goaltending side of things for this game coming up on Wednesday?
Oh, absolutely. You know, he had won like 7 straight starts, so he was, you know, far from a problem. I think he and Gustafson have been, you know, an incredible 1-2 punch, and it's the biggest question for me is, like, who's going to start game one of the playoffs if they started tomorrow, right? You saw what happened last year in the playoffs at the St. Louis Blues series where they started with Fleury and then they went to Talbot Lilial too late. So I think that's the biggest question mark I have for this team going into the playoffs. But I don't think one game or one bad game is going to really affect them too much from a goaltending standpoint.
So my kind of follow-up question to that is, Is Fleury having a resurgence this year? You know, I think a lot of people were kind of wondering when that playoff shift happened last year. Is this kind of the end of it?
Well, I mean, if you watch him in practice and watch him every day, and, like, the guy looks like he's 25 years old. You know, like, I don't think, you know, I think he had some struggles early in the season, especially the first few games where he got pulled. But I think he has hockey left in him, and he's obviously been playing at a really high level for a good part of this last stretch, and it doesn't look like he's going to retire this year, so probably be back next year with Gustafson as the 1-2 punch in net. So, you know, that's been such a big part of why the Wild are, you know, kind of fighting for a first place in the division right now.
This is the Hockey Show with JJ and Ryan. We're on the phone with Joe Smith of TheAthletic.com, covers the Wild. Let's stick with Fleury, because obviously I think he's a big attraction for everyone around the league there in Minnesota. And, you know, you've covered the NHL for a long time. There are great guys to cover, and there are terrible guys to cover as far as conversation. So just get into the pleasure of getting to cover a guy with that type of personality. And, you know, even after losses, it still seems like he's a great guy to maybe approach and, you know, get his thoughts on a game.
Well, just you look at that game against St. Louis and where you wanted to fight Binnington, right? That's just, you know, he told me a couple days beforehand, he's like, hey, I want to get in a fight before my career is over. That's one of my bucket lists. And then 2 days later, he goes out and length of the ice to try to fight Binnington. And then afterwards, he's like, the famous line of, you know, one of the guys told me they got the pretty big and hip in their nutsack. Can I say nutsack, please? You know, and is that proper?
Yeah,
that
you're good. You're good.
So yeah, he's just a fun guy to cover. Like, I was in covering the deadline in Calgary at the team hotel in the lobby doing work, and Fleury came by to get some coffee, and he's like, hey, what's going on? You hear any news, any rumors? And I was like, oh, it's pretty quiet right now. And then all of a sudden, you know, they made 3 trades in the last hour. And so the next practice, he came off the ice and hit me the back of the leg just for fun. And he's like, hey, I guess we brought up both wrong on the deadline, huh? And the guy started laughing. Like, he's just one of those guys that it just keeps things light. The guys love him. And obviously one of my favorite people I've ever covered as far as just conversational and just and talking about hockey or his favorite pranks he's pulled and all that stuff.
Do you think he would have won in that fight if we had gotten to witness the majesty of it?
That's a good question. I've never seen him fight other than a clip of him in junior.
Yeah.
Last time he fought and he broke his knuckle. So I think Dean Evason and the team are really happy he didn't get to fight.
Yeah, obviously.
Because he didn't want to hurt break before the playoffs. But I think everybody in the stands and the press box, whatever, wanted to see a goalie fight because he's one of the most exciting things you probably see in hockey.
Yeah, everybody was upset at the refs. And, you know, earlier this year, we saw the exact same thing here in Colorado. Alexander Georgiev went to center ice and kind of challenged Jordan Binnington. The refs kind of shooed everybody away and didn't let any sort of altercation happen. I guess your stance on the refs getting involved and stopping goalie fights when obviously everybody is on board except for the referees, apparently.
Well, I mean, clearly it's a focus for them to not let that happen, right? And I think, I'm sure from a league perspective or a team perspective, they don't want their goalies fighting. They're not used to fighting. And the worst that can happen is have your number one goalie or number two, you know, get injured.
Yeah, like a broken knuckle.
Never does. Yeah, like all it takes is one. Like do you want any of your star forwards? You want Nate MacKinnon fighting? You know, I don't think so. You know, so I think it's like they're just protecting the players in it, even though people who would love to see that happen are the fans, right? But I think, especially, it's harder to get a fight like that because you always have to go length of the ice to go start it. So you have plenty of time to get in between. Not like it's off the opening faceoff where both guys just go at it.
I guess I want to get a little bit into just you, Joe. I mean, obviously, moving from Tampa Bay to, did you move to Minneapolis or St. Paul? I guess
Minneapolis.
Okay, so moving from Tampa Bay to Minneapolis, I guess obviously a geographic difference for you. We know that, but as far as covering the teams, what have you noticed? What have been your favorite parts, both from the geographic sense and from covering these two different NHL franchises?
Well, from a personal standpoint, like we love living like downtown right by the Mississippi River. So, like we love being active and going for runs and skiing and all that stuff. So I think from a personal standpoint, both of us are from the Midwest, Michigan and Indiana. So I think, you know, we get the people and kind of the easy transition that we've been through winters before, you know, kind of thing. And from a professional level, like it was just kind of a reinvigorating move. I covered the same team for 10, 11 years and multiple cup runs and 71 playoff games in 3 years. And I just felt like I wanted another challenge. And going up to Minnesota, like the hockey market and fan base is incredible. Entire state or region there are hockey and Wild fans. And so that's been the readership there and the comments and the engagement. It's been great. And just building new relationships with people like Jared Spurgeon and Bill Guerin, and they've been really open as far as access is concerned to do the kind of fun, in-depth stories that I did in Tampa Bay for so long. So from a personal level and from a professional level, it's been really good so far. And, you know, it's fun to try to cover a team in a different timing of their championship arc, right, and see where it can go from there.
I have to ask, is it a little disappointing to be leaving John Cooper behind on the regular? Like, he seems, with our limited experience playoffs, you know, we only get him here once a year, to be quite an enjoyable coach to interact with, speak with, pick the brain of.
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. I mean, I talked to him actually this week for a long time because I did that story that ran today on Athletic about 10 years ago today, the Lightning hired him, and how we may not see that very much again, other than maybe Jared Bednar might make it 10 years, obviously, in Colorado. But just an incredible career and crazy journey from a lawyer in Wall Street to being a head coach. And I obviously enjoyed many chats with him and some beers over the years and like that. So we do keep in touch. And so I'm sure you never know what will happen if they go on a long run. And you know, if the Wild aren't, you know, playing anymore, then maybe I'll pop on and do some more Lightning coverage too. But a long way from that happening, for sure.
Awesome, Joe. Well, we appreciate the time. We know you got to run as the Minnesota Wild face the Chicago Blackhawks here shortly. So thanks for spending some time with us. Will we see you here in town on Wednesday night, 8 p.m. TNT?
You will see me Wednesday night. So looking forward to seeing everybody and hanging out. Watch
right
a really good hockey game.
And we'll see how the playoffs land. Maybe we'll spend some time together in the first round as well. So, again, thanks for hanging out with us. And, yeah, enjoy the game day.
Sounds good. Take care, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks, Joe.
There you have it. Joe Smith of The Athletic. Great conversation. I love the guests that we pull. I mean, that was something we forgot to do for a while, you know, before I had the baby. I love bringing it back. It's just good to have conversations, insights from around the league.
It helps break up the monotony of just talking about the Avalanche, you know, pretending like we know what we're talking about in the NHL. I think there's a lot to learn from that conversation. Something that just blew my mind was I guess never realized that the Mississippi River
starts,
was all the way up there.
Does it start there?
I was looking. I was actually just looking on the map. But my mind is a little blown. Like, I just never
knew.
I
thought he said Mississippi, but I wasn't sure because I know in Minnesota there's a lot of, you know, Mississauga Lake and...
Lake Itasca in Minnesota is the
genesis.
Is the origin point for the Mississippi River.
There you go. Right. Lake Itasca. Yeah, fun conversation.
That was awesome, though.
Yeah, and, you know, we could all listen to Marc-Andre Fleury stories all day long, right? I wonder if he rolled his eyes like, oh, another radio station just wants to talk Marc-Andre Fleury and Ryan Reeves. But those two were such pivotal pieces, right? I remember you and I talking on this very radio show when Vegas got rid of Marc-Andre Fleury and Ryan Reeves, how detrimental that is to the locker room. Minnesota says, you know what, why don't we bring those two paired? Because having both those guys in a dressing room just does such great things for your team.
Yeah, and I mean, Gerard Gallant, obviously a big fan of Reeves, to bring him to the Rangers. I'm sure he wasn't, you know, super happy about letting him go at the time. Rangers are obviously doing okay. Reeves is doing okay. And, you know, he may not be a guy that you like playing against, having an opponent playing on a divisional opponent. But the more that I see of him out there in the world as a personality, the more I enjoy it. Like, I still laugh thinking about this Super Bowl prediction video the Rangers did with him last year. You know, he did a great interview on TNT last week with his shirt off,
mm-hmm.
you know, after scoring goals.
Had to show off those tattoos because he spent a lot of money on them, right?
Like, as a personality, you like the guy.
Indeed. And at 37 years of age, it's like, shoot, we almost discovered this guy too late, right?
Yeah.
I mean, he didn't have this much camera time earlier in his career. But, yeah, that'll do it. Thanks again to Joe Smith of TheAthletic.com, and thanks to TheAthletic.com for letting us borrow him for a segment. But we'll be back to talk some Avs hockey. Of course, you and I, credentialed Avs reporters, we got to talk Avs somehow, and then the mixed bag skate to end the show. So we'll be right back through the break. JJ Jerez, Ryan Boulding, right here on Mile High Sports.
Let's go, Colorado!
Welcome back. Colorado's biggest and best live hockey radio show. This is the hockey show. JJ Jerez, Ryan Boulding. We got the Foo Fighters playing on the air. Why is that, Ryan?
Today is the 1 year anniversary of the unfortunate passing of Taylor Hawkins, drummer for the Foo Fighters. I believe Danny snuck in, what did we get, Coattail Riders at the beginning? What was the first song you played?
Life of Illusion.
By who?
That was by, I mean, it says Foo Fighters in the system.
Oh, I don't
is
know.
It not Foo Fighters?
I don't know. Maybe it's an obscure track.
There's Foo Fighters that you haven't even discovered yet?
I don't know about
No. Oh, no.
They actually, though, they did release, like, thousands of live songs from different eras. There's some interesting bangers and stuff in there that you didn't know. Live covers and stuff.
I'm sure I didn't know.
They actually, I've looked for this for years. Years ago, I don't know. I'm going to say 1999 MTV New Year's. They played Dead Kennedys cover Holiday in Cambodia with Serge Tankian from System of a Down on vocals. And for years, I was like, man, I would love to actually like hear a version of this. And they put it out, that version. It's out there.
Hooray.
Yeah.
Hooray for you.
JJ's thrilled.
I actually accidentally stopped listening for a second there.
Yeah, that's typifies this radio show experience. The good news is he wasn't looking at houses.
Let's get into the Colorado Avalanche. Of course, having a strong finish to the year, right? I mean, slowly players trickling back and then other players trickle out of the lineup. I mean, the difficulty that they've had and to be where they are, I think Jared Benner absolutely deserves at least a nominee for the Jack Adams. But I want to talk about Alexandar Georgiev right now because I think he is the sole reason that they are playing this well. Yes, you're getting goals out of Cale Makar. Yes, Mikko Rantanen and Nathan MacKinnon have been contributing as well. But other than that, that's pretty much it. They've had to survive on low-scoring games. They've had to survive on defensive structure, which has been a pride point of this team, right, dating back to last year. But Alexandar Georgiev has been there to bail them out over and over and over. I mean, even last night against the Arizona Coyotes, the Avalanche had a good control over that game, right? But there were spurts where the Coyotes, you know, the Avalanche didn't have quite the lead yet or it was still 1-1. The Coyotes find good opportunities, and Georgiev was there to shut him down. I mean, his initial reaction, his first shot reaction, I think is second to none. It might be better than any goalie I've ever seen. Just his first save, that his ability to punch or his ability to grab with his glove. I love what Georgiev is doing. He needs more attention from a national standpoint because I think it's him that is currently the team's MVP.
I'm going to agree and disagree. I think he has been phenomenal. I think he is what everyone hoped he would be. You know, we were obviously during training camp preseason a little concerned about the adjustment period, thought maybe he'd get off to a slow start. He did not. He did have some stumbles here and there after breaks, prolonged stretches of not playing. He's a groove goalie, I think, you know, and he's a guy that will just work until he collapses. And so he needs to be stopped. He needs to be taken out of the lineup to have some breaks, some rest plugged in. But I mean, he has been phenomenal. He's so calm. Like he said, he makes the great first save. I don't think he gives up a ton of rebounds, but he can do the scrambly stuff too. And that's important. And just interacting with him, you know, he's not as abnormal as a lot of goalies are.
He's no Marc-Andre Fleury in terms of bubbliness even after a loss, right? But he's not miserable to talk to.
No, he is a reader. He reads a lot. He's an interesting fellow and is very quick to deflect any sort of personal acclaim to the team. But, I mean, he can win these games with high shots if they happen, which seems rare these days. I mean, he made 17 saves on 18 shots last night. I wouldn't say that was necessarily a tough win for him, but he was there when it mattered. And the last time the Avs played the Coyotes, I mean, the Coyotes did not have a lot of shots, including none in the third period. You know, going into overtime, I don't think they had an overtime shot either, so it's not like he had to do a lot of work there. But, you know, he's a goalie that has played in games where the Avs score on the first shot of the game. So he has a lead built in and can do it. He's a goalie that can play when he hasn't faced a lot of shots in the first period. He's just cold. He's just ready. He's always talking about you just let go, reset, and you be ready for the next thing. Like, you don't think about playing with a lead. You don't think about starting the game with a lead in the first minute. You're just ready for the next thing, ready for the next thing. I think he really has this sort of goalie mentality figured out. He's a calm guy. You don't see him get very worked up.
We did once this year, if you remember, he went postal on his posts, for lack of a better term.
Yes. That was early in the year.
Crossbar just took a beating
but
from
like,
his paddle.
You know, in the locker room, he's not very fiery.
No.
I think he seems timid, and I think it's a language thing with the media, where I don't think he feels like he's confident in his ability to speak English, but it's been fine.
His English is perfect.
Yeah, so he's been very impressive. But the reason I say I also disagree is I do think that MacKinnon and Rantanen have been driving this team. You know, the goaltending helps. The goaltending has played key roles in many games. But, I mean, this is a team that scores a lot. The Colorado Avalanche have a plus 39 goal differential right now, and it's like all MacKinnon and Rantanen.
Yeah, exactly, which I think is a little bit worrisome. So I guess you say you disagree about Georgiev being this team's MVP at this moment in time. Who do you throw in there?
I think it's Mikko. I mean, you want to say this is the year that MacKinnon deserves heart consideration.
I just want him to get 100 points. Let's get him over that threshold already.
We're close. Absolutely, Mikko is going to hit 50 goals.
100%.
Nathan MacKinnon's at 92, 93 points. I mean,
Mikko would have had his 48th if it wasn't for some dirty ref out there.
Well, he looked to have his 48th when somehow he tried to steal a goal from Makarov, where everybody's like, did that touch him? I don't know. And then, yeah, I mean, for a guy who's at 47 goals, I mean, he didn't pick a good shot when he just put it right into the ref's feet there. But you had to appreciate his effort, working his tail off to try and get a goal at the end of a game with no goalie in net, drawing a penalty. His season has just been miraculous. And like I said, you want to see MacKinnon get that real heavy heart candidacy. And he has driven this team. He's got 19 home games with a point. He's on, what, a 10, 11-game point streak. He's doing the work. But Mikko has been there all year just putting up goals, just carrying the team. You know, when Nate was out, Landeskog's been out. When guys weren't scoring, there's Mikko. The guy is on the score sheet a lot.
Kept him afloat when times were rough, for sure.
And sometimes you can outscore deficiencies in the net. I mean, Jonas Johansson didn't necessarily have a super good game in his last start, but the Avs outscored the opposition, right, to win.
Ottawa, barely. Barely by the skin of their teeth did they hang on to that game. But, hey, they got it done, which brings me to the other potential MVP, not so much most valuable player, but most valuable person, Jared Bednar. He gets his extension 3 more years with the Colorado Avalanche, at least. I'm sure, you know, that'll probably get extended because this window is still open and it's going to be open for the next 3 years. I think he's going to manage it well. So your thoughts on the Bednar extension? I think it's great to have this guy around because we've loved him so far, right?
Yeah, to see his evolution and his growth, the way he conducts himself as a person, the way he handles himself with the media, the way you can pick his brain and he's willing to share details to open up the vault of knowledge that he has. And his ability to self-reflect. You know, I asked him about how he's grown since the 2016-17 season. You know, I think it would have been easy for a lot of people, including Avs management, to hold that year against him, even though he came in September, right before training camp. He came in with one friendly assistant coach in Nolan Pratt, who had just happened to precede him here under Patrick Waugh. And then, you know, made changes to his coaching staff, brought in Ray Bennett, brought in Parkala. But, I mean, his first year, it was not a good year, and it was a team of aging or barely NHL-level players, right? And to see the growth from there to where the Avalanche are, yes, the talent plays a lot in that, right? But he has to get along with the superstars, right? We're seeing it with Daryl Sutter. We've seen it with guys like Ken Hitchcock. You know, these for lack of a better word, great coaches who grade on players who become tuned out because they can't, that the just the way that they are is hard to deal with. And Jared isn't that way. Like, players fawn over him. I talked when the Avalanche had lost like 5-6 games in a row there and everybody was calling for his head. I talked to Andrew Cogliano and he's like, this is one of the best coach teams I have ever played on. You know, this coach knows what he's doing. He prepares us. His staff prepares us as best as we could ever be prepared. And it is on us to respond, you know, and he's given this team legs to grow. He even talked pretty honestly and candidly at the beginning of the season with all of the injuries that had happened. Like, this is a roster of players that are not the MacKinnons and Rantanens and Landeskogs and Helms and Mansons who can just take feedback and go do it. Like, this is, you've got guys like Foodie on the team, you know, you've got guys like Martin Kaut at the time, you've Sampo Ranta, Shane Bowers, all these guys rotating through the lineup who need time to implement the changes, to learn, to grow. And he set his expectations with the fans through the media that this is the process, right? He's a guy of coaching on multiple levels. He's capable of coaching multiple talent levels and getting the best out of his players.
And just an all-around nice guy, right? I'll never forget which year it was, but the playoff series where they lost to the Nashville Predators, they ended up having to play Andrew Hammond. Both Bernier and Varley went down. They got eliminated. After his press conference, he went and stood outside the press conference and was there to go shake every member of the media's hand. He shook my hand because I was the first one out. And then I think it was Jean Martineau at the time pulled him away and said, no, Jared, you don't have to do this and tell everybody, you know, have a good summer. Like, let's just go. But that just speaks to who he is, right? The gentlemanly, very nice, and, you know, not against anyone, wants to head the same direction together.
And he's funny. He likes to take shots. He laughs at jokes. He, you know, picks on some guys. He's picked on Mile High Sports, Eric Dean for his shirt. He's picked on Peter Baugh lately, you know?
Yeah. So good to have him around. But that's it for us for this portion of the show. We got to get to the mixed bag skate. Fun mixed bag skate, I think, planned my first mixed bag skate in 6 weeks. So I've had a lot of time to think about this one and prepare it. So
it's kind of like the dessert of the show.
It is.
You get through the meat, you get through the potatoes, and now we get the treats, the sweets.
The sweets, yeah. Rapid fire sweets. So stick around. We'll be right back. This is the Hockey Show. JJ Jerez, Ryan Boulding, Danny Bailey, Mile High Sports.
I play hockey and I fornicate because it's the two most fun things in cold weather.
Welcome back to the Hockey Show. I love this show. I love how it's evolved over the last several seasons, and we got those little bits and clips and our own little, you know, we do the mixed bag skate, we do the matinee money. We're having a good time here.
Even when it seems to get stale, we bring in some guests, we do solo intros and solo shows.
And we do our best with jokes, right?
JJ dresses up in his bull costume.
I like to think I'm funny. We had a conversation off air during that break about Alan Roach. I have a quick little tidbit about him from yesterday because it made me laugh really hard. After first intermission, I'm walking up to, you know, the lobby area of the press box to go get another water, and he goes probably to do the same thing. He walks right in front of me, right? And he takes these couple steps, one, two, three, and as he gets to the top step, he says to himself, "Oh, yeah." And I just start laughing to myself. I'm like, do you like hearing your own voice as much as the rest of us like hearing your own voice? And of course, he didn't know I was there. He just said it to himself.
Maybe he did. He just crop dusted you and was like, oh yeah.
Who knows? But truly hilarious moment right there from Alan Roach for me.
The reason we were talking about Roach is Peter Baugh, the Athletic, is probably writing a story about him and asked Jared Bednar if he had gotten to know Alan Roach. I think this was during a post-game press conference, and maybe it was morning skate. He asked Jared Bednar, have you gotten to know Alan Roach? And Jared said, no. And everybody kind of chuckled, and there was this long pause. And I said, well, that story's dead. And then everybody broke out laughing, and it's kind of been a little bit of a running gag here for a minute.
But just another testament to how loose and fun it can be with Jared Bednar at times, right? Let's get to the mixed bag skate itself. We got a couple topics to cover and not too much time to do it. So are you ready? You ready to go quickly here?
Here goes.
Michigan goal scored last night by Columbus Blue Jackets forward Kent Johnson. My problem with it wasn't truly a Michigan. He more picked it up while it was kind of already up on its side and you know, did the second half of the Michigan. But for me, for it to qualify as a true Michigan, you have to pick it up off the flat surface off a stable ground, right?
And I never saw the replay of him picking it up, so I can't speak to that. To me, it was equally as impressive though, because I'm pretty sure he was on his offhand. He, instead of curling it toe up into the net, it was toe down. It was like this weird reverse shovel.
Sure.
So I give him points for that.
All right, fair enough. Mikko Rantanen comes out this week with a little sponsorship and partnership he did with Truly. I guess my question to you here, if you had an alcohol sponsor you and you had to do this kind of sponsorship, who is it?
Oh, man. That's tough. It's definitely not Malort. I can tell you that.
Malort?
Yeah.
What is that?
Oh, buddy. You don't even want to know.
All right.
That's how bad it is.
Okay.
I would take Fireball.
Gross.
I mean, they are, you follow them on social, or just look at them on social media. They get the vibe right.
You know, I'm pretty sure there's antifreeze in there. like the same that you would put in a car.
Well,
like,
it keeps me from freezing up inside. That's the point. Right. Or, you know, pick a good IPA. Let's go with Upslope. I like Upslope Brewing.
Okay. Shout out Upslope.
Yeah.
Call us if you want to sponsor.
Could Mikko Rantanen have been any less enthused to be doing that sponsorship?
I mean, that's just kind of who he is, right? He likes to just, let's get through this, and he'll give you good answers. He'll give you good conversation, but he's not going to do it with, you know, sprinkles.
Pizzazz.
Pizzazz.
Jazz hands.
Perfect word.
He walked out past the media. It was an optional morning skate with that box, and I thought it was weird. I was looking down at my phone, and I saw the Avs logo on the box, and I'm like, that's odd. And he got like 50 feet down the hallway, and then I think it was Peter Bosz shouted at him, "Hey, Mikko, where's the party?" And he said, "I'm not telling you." And he just kept going. Like, he's also very quick with his comebacks. They don't have to be necessarily zingers, but he was ready.
I'd be down to party with Mikko Rantanen, that's for sure. Let's move on here. AJ Greer cross-checks Mike Hoffman in the face. The real story is Mike Hoffman going to social media and giving his own little two cents about how he once got suspended for cross-checking somebody in the back ahead for two games. AJ Greer gets suspended for one game as he's sitting there with his nasty scab and cut on his lip and really driving the point home.
Darn, it couldn't have happened to a nicer person, Mike Hoffman.
That's your take on it? Well, very AJ Greer move too, right?
I've buy him a beer. I'm an AJ Greer stan. I was there when he was drafted.
I like AJ Greer. I love players that have that fire in them, right? And that's kind of what I've lost my, I guess, love for JT Compher is when he came into the league. I thought that's the type of player he was going to be. I thought he was going to be the one in front of the net after whistle scrums, and that suddenly flamed out of his game a little bit.
What do they call it?
The Bo Byram thing.
Urine and sandpaper, since we can't say the other word. I think, you know, it's just, I don't know what I was going to say. I forgot.
Cool.
Oh, Gabriel Landeskog. I mean, he used to get suspended for cross-checking guys in the face, like, regularly. I mean, it happens.
Yeah, it does. Joe Biden, I think he was doing some sort of speech in Canada and took the second to mention how he doesn't like the Leafs. Why does he not like the Leafs? Because they beat the Philadelphia Flyers earlier in the season. Who hasn't beat the Philadelphia Flyers this year? Apparently his wife is a big Flyers fan. But your thoughts on Joe Biden going into Canada and just straight up stomping on their team, right? That's Canada's team right there.
I think it's hilarious. You know, there's got to be a degree of, just like when the Canucks were good and, you know, all of Canada hated the Canucks kind of concept, I imagine there is some disdain for Toronto and their ability to be so good and not get it to the next level within Canada. So it may have been a bit endearing. I'm pretty sure, without totally looking it up, I know he lives in Delaware now, but he has ties to Pennsylvania. I think he was a senator there maybe for a
long time.
Doesn't
he live in Washington, D.C.?
Where he's from there. Well, now.
Oh, well, that's what
he
said.
But he's got a house in Delaware.
Ah, gotcha, gotcha.
Anyway, I think it's hilarious.
Fun stuff.
Yeah.
Good to throw.
Speaking
hockey.
Of Joe Biden, I asked Avalanche PR if they had heard from the White House about going to the White House to be congratulated for their victory, and they said they have not.
I don't know why, but for some reason I feel like they were going to do it while they were in Washington, but Joe Biden had to suddenly leave for some reason. I don't know where I got that, but that just in my head as
I
if
feel
that's
like
what happened.
The world has just been on fire for a while, so.
The QMJHL bans fighting effectively. I guess, do you see this trickling eventually up to the NHL, or what is your thought on the QMJHL trying to say, enough is enough, we don't want this in our game anymore?
It's funny, Jared Bednar talked about this the other day, too. I don't mind kids not fighting. You know, the ultimate issue here is concussions, brain injuries, CTE. And
broken knuckles.
And like Marc-Andre Fleury's broken knuckle. But you don't, developing brains, I think, need a little more protection. There's a reason why, you know, checking has slid up the age scale some in youth hockey. I don't dislike it, right? I think, you know, on some level, you need to be prepared for a lot of fighting in, you know, semi-pro, pro hockey on the lower levels. But I think you're seeing it in the NHL. There's a lot less fighting. We're not getting goalie fights anymore. You know, it's really about protecting the head. It's not as much about fighting as it is about preventing repeated blows to the head.
Well, not to mention the NHL recently made a move to protect the clean hits that suddenly have to answer the bell, right? So that instigator penalty, they're trying to enforce that a little bit heavier. So, you know, you see it starting. You see the demise of fighting.
Having, you know, kids, teenagers, 18-year-olds throwing blows, I don't think that adds much to the game.
And the last thing the NHL wants is more Bowen Byrams, who can come into the league and really be somebody and be a star, and instead has to kind of wrestle with concussion issues for his first couple years. So less of that.
Joey,
right?
Hischen. Yeah,
exactly. Pekka Rinne gets his statue unveiled today right outside Bridgestone Arena. Cool stuff for Pekka Rinne.
Hope it looks better than Dustin Brown's statue.
It is all right. It was all right, but we've seen some terrible statues. It's got to be hard to make an accurate statue out of metal, right? I mean,
I don't know. Have you seen Michelangelo's David?
That's not out of metal.
It's out of marble, bro.
Right, exactly.
Way
so
harder.
I think marble might be easier.
Way harder.
I don't know. Do you know that for a fact?
With the chisel.
Do you know enough about sculpting to confidently say that?
I know.
My question to you, Ryan.
Just sculpting these abs.
The Ryan Bolding statue that eventually gets erected.
Yeah.
Where is it going?
I would like to, where's the most annoying place? I'd probably like your driveway.
Cool.
I don't know. Let's put it in Crested Butte. There's a cool dragon statue there.
That's what I thought your answer would be, right? Maybe a you on chair 34 of.
Yeah. I want my statue permanently on a chairlift.
Yeah.
So people, like every one time it comes around, only three people can get on that chair.
Yeah. And they have to sit next to the great, late great Ryan Bolding, take some selfies with it, right?
Yeah.
Last question for you, Ryan. I know this one's near
and
dear.
He just killed you off, too.
Yeah, I know.
Didn't say you had to be dead to get a statue.
Yeah, thank you, Dave. The late great. Jesus.
Oh, sorry about that. Well, anyway, more shame for you. Your DU Pioneers lose in the first round of the Frozen
I'm still
Four.
Waiting for that game to start, and I think they are, too.
I guess, how does it feel?
It
are you
hurts.
Shame?
It hurts. Now we got to listen to Arif talk about Michigan this and Michigan that, and Michigan won 11-1 and blah, blah, blah. It hurts. I think there were, and college hockey is tough, right? Because you can have one bad game and it's over. It's tough. I didn't think that they had a great start. Their goalie was injured. He did his best. I wasn't thrilled with the second goal that he gave up. But watching that game, it was just like once they got it going, it was too late, you know, and that's the unfortunate part. My real big takeaway from any time I watch college hockey is just how sloppy it is compared to pro hockey, even at, you know, lower levels. And that's not, you know, a diss against the players and the staff and that kind of thing, but it's just, you know, it's crazy the difference.
If there's one thing that this hockey show has taught both of us is that you can't win them all, right? But as long as you're in contention, as long as you're there, hey, I think there's still something to be proud of because there's a lot of hockey teams that wish they would have just made that tournament, and DU is there every year. So
yeah,
we got to at least appreciate
it
for that.
We were trying to push for the most.
This was the first year I'd been to a DU game in a long time, so maybe I was the jinx. Who knows?
It was you. The second I put on my jersey, I knew it was over.
Well, thanks for hanging out with us today. That'll do it for this
Yeah, don't forget
edition.
I'm still alive.
Still alive.
Yeah.
Still not late. He's early. Yeah, catch replays on any podcast providers. Of course, we're always on Twitch, and you could even find us on YouTube if you want to catch our pretty faces doing this show too. A lot of hand gestures that you're going to be missing if you're just only listening. So
the Avs play next Saturday, so we may have a later show. 7 o'clock
next Saturday against Dallas. Here at home,
the Stars. Big D coming right up.
Only 4 home games remaining, so here he goes. Strap in, playoffs right around the corner. Thanks for hanging out with us today. We'll be back next week. This is the Hockey Show for Ryan. I am JJ. Danny Bailey, thank you so much for everything you do. We'll be back. See ya.